Jan and her husband run the Trustees of Lifeway Ministries. They are the trustees, is that right?
That's right.
Of Lifeway Ministries, Lifeway Bible School. Trevor and Jan are national coordinators for Rise Up Together New Zealand. Isn't that a wonderful title? I've been hearing what they're doing throughout New Zealand, and it's the best thing I've ever heard of for a long, long time. They've put out this magazine, Rise Up Together New Zealand. Remember the Together New Zealand. Pick one up, look through it. They've also got a video available, and if you would like a copy of it, there's a phone number on the back page, and any other material, if you give them a buzz, you'll have it sent to you. We'll bless you. We're going to have a mighty time with Jan.
Do you know, when I was growing up, I wish I was a Jane. Ever been like that? I wanted to be taller. I wanted straight hair, not curls all over the place. And I wanted to be a lady. But unfortunately, God's given me a personality. Well, first of all, I'm short, and I've got curly hair, and he's made me a tomboy. And my mother used to despair with me. I'd be climbing trees and whistling to the boys down the road. They were my cousins. We grew up. We were built treehouse, cowboys and Indians. I used to love the dolls, too. My mother used to just shake her head in despair and ever wonder whether I'm going to ever turn out to be a lady. Well, you know something? I have. But I'm me, and I think that what God is going to say this weekend, that you are uniquely you. Don't try and be something that you're not. I tried that for a while. I tried to be quiet, and I tried to be elegant, and I tried to be ever so gracious, and I was an absolute pain to everybody around. Of course, none of you ladies would be like that, would you? But God said to me one day, I love you for who you are, and I've created you for my pleasure, and so therefore I've created you just as I want you. I mean, if we were all of the one kind, I guess it would be pretty boring, wouldn't it? It would be a pretty boring sort of life. And as I often keep reminding my husband, well, honey, with my temperament, you see, I'm mainly Scots, I have some Irish in me, plus a little bit of French and Norwegian. The Irish and the Scots personality makes life interesting, believe you me. And so I say to my husband, well, it keeps you on your toes. But before we start, let's pray. Father, we thank you for your presence here. We thank you for your anointing of your Holy Spirit in this place. And we thank you, Father, that we're here by divine appointment, each one of us. That, Father, you're speaking into our hearts. And that, Father, that things are going to be birthed in ladies' spirits this weekend. Things, Lord, that they've never dreamed possible. But Father, you're going to put your hand upon them and say, "But my daughter, this is what I'd have you do. Obey what I'm saying to you, then take the next step, then obey, and then step on again." So Father, we just once again say we are totally available for you to do whatever you want to do. We welcome your presence, Holy Spirit. And we thank you, Father, for Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. Well, I was given the topic of character and emotions, and when Pat gave me that, I thought, boy, that's really for me, because if anybody's been an emotional type, it's been me. And as I said last night, I've had lots happen, lots has come my way. And it really, the things that we've gone through as a family, just very, very briefly, my first son was born Down syndrome. He's mentally handicapped. My second son, we nearly lost him at birth. He died at 16 and a half years of age. My third daughter, my third child, Rebecca, well, everything went perfectly for her. And but you know, in that accident I was just sharing very briefly last night, we nearly lost our daughter too. Plus many, many other things. But through it all, I have learned to trust in Jesus Christ. And as what I was trying to say last night is the things that come against your life, the roads that God asks you to walk down sometime, leave behind pools of refreshing so that others can be refreshed. Don't leave behind bitter waters. Because you see, not only does it affect you, but it really does affect everybody else around you. So let's purpose in our hearts, as precious women of God, that wherever we go, we're going to leave a beautiful fragrance behind us. not a horrible smell, but a beautiful fragrance of Jesus Christ. Obviously, at all times, sometimes we've all read books and heard sermons regarding women's emotions, their temperaments, their sexuality, etc. But the area that I want to cover is, what do we do with our emotions? Do we use them for us or against us? Do we use them for us or against us? A quote that I heard just recently was this: what we are is a gift from God. What we can become is our gift to God. I'm going to repeat that. What we are is a gift from God. What we can become is our gift to God. Isn't that true? And I don't know about you, but I've got a longing and a hunger in my heart to make my life worthy for Jesus. It's a hunger. And I once heard somebody say, oh God, fill me with an unsatisfied satisfaction for you. In other words, and I believe that's what we should be like, ladies. Always going on to fresh things, always seeking more things in God. Don't ever get to that place where you sit there and think, well, Lord, I've arrived. I'm extremely comfortable, God. I don't want to go any further. And I tell you something, we can pray that prayer. And God will say, okay, if that's how you want it. But I believe that each one of us, God would have us stir ourselves and keep pressing on, keep pressing on. Don't you think that? Don't you? Isn't that the desire of your heart? I trust it is as this weekend goes on. The dictionary definition of character is this: the combination of qualities or features that distinguishes one person or group from another. The dictionary definition of emotions is this: any strong feeling as of joy, sorrow, reverence, hate, or love, arising subjectively rather than through conscious mental effort. We don't sort of wake up in the morning and think, right, today, God, I'm going to be joyful. Today, I'm going to have a reverence in my heart. We can say those things, but we don't consciously start the day off and think, I'm going to be this way. Things trigger us off. I mean, we might start off good, but as Jayne was saying, she was washing her dishes at 6 o'clock this morning from last night, and things don't always go sweet like you see on TV around breakfast time, do they, ladies? Doesn't round our household, and so that can set the tone for the day for a woman. It can really set the tone for the day, but it's what we do with it, whether it continues on that way or not. I remember once Rebecca and this young man that was boarding at our house, I don't know what happened this particular night, but they were at each other's throats. Now, they were really good friends, but they were at each other's throats. And I took them dinner, and look, honestly, they were just like, they were pecking at each other. It was awful. And I just said to them, look, hang on a minute, guys. I said, do you see what you're doing to each other? And they sort of said, what? And I said, you're picking on each other. Why is it? And they said, we don't know. So right then and there, I took authority over a spirit of contention. And I said, give me your hands, we're going to pray. And they, you know, teenagers are like, you know, but I was forceful. And I said, give me your hands, we are going to pray. Because I know that's not really how you feel in your heart. And it's a real contentious thing that's trying to come in. Let's do away with it. And so we joined hands and we prayed, they prayed, and it went just like that. And I believe, you see, that's the authority that God has given to us, each one, to cut down the forces of evil, the onslaught that come against us. We're going to speak about that more often. But, you know, more a bit later on. But the peace of God came back in that house. But, you see, as women, I think that we have that as the mothers, and we spend most of the time with the children. We have within our hands that ability to tear down or to build up. Isn't that true? Let's be builders. So let's take authority over those things if you see them coming in, and let's be peacemakers in our home. I believe that adversity builds character and Christ-likeness. And in my notes, I've written it like this: adversity builds character and Christ-likeness. It's a progression that's going up and up and up. And you might say, adversity. Nobody really likes to speak about that today. Pain and suffering. But wherever I go, that's what I hear most about. Isn't that true? But you see, and because we're Christians, it doesn't mean to say that we're exempt from it either. I haven't found that so. But as I say, it's what we do with it. As it comes our way, what do we do with it? Let's turn to Romans chapter 5 from verses 3 and 4. Romans chapter 5, verses 1 to 4, especially verses 3 and 4. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also rejoice in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit whom he has given us. Isn't that a beautiful scripture? When suffering produces perseverance, perseverance, character, and character, hope. What happens if we turn that formula around and we reverse this formula that we've just spoken about? If we lack hope, I believe it's because we lack character. If we lack character, I believe it's because we lack perseverance. And if we lack perseverance, it is because we have not responded properly to the trials and tribulations that we all face. I'm going to say that again, because I believe it's so true. If we find we lack hope, it's because we lack character. If we lack character, it is because we lack perseverance. And if we lack perseverance, it is because we have not responded properly to the trials and tribulations that we all face. I particularly want to emphasize perseverance for you, woman. I know in my life, up to the last 4 years, I didn't persevere hardly at all. I let everything wash over me. Everything that came my way, I just kind of took it and let all these things wash over me. But in the last 4 years, I've learned something. I've learned that God wants us to arise and to be bold, to be vital, to be strong, to be woman of backbone, to be woman of character, to be woman of grit, to have that steel in your backbone. No matter what comes your way, you are going to stand. And having done all, you're going to stand. Do you know that you can be a battle axe for God? This is in the right sense. Do you know that you can be a battle axe for God? Now, I don't mean a battle axe, ladies. And I guess we've all been there at some time. But listen to this. In Jeremiah 51, verse 20. Jeremiah 51, verse 20. I heard this on a video once and it just excited me. Because I thought, great, there's an excuse to be a battle axe, but in the right way. And it says in the NIV, it says, "You are my war club." My war club, or my battle axe, my weapon for battle. So it's okay to be a battle axe, okay? With you, I shatter nations. With you, I destroy kingdoms. With you, I shatter horse and rider. With you, I shatter chariot and driver. And so on. You read that the rest of those verses. But what God is saying here, and I believe what God is saying throughout this nation, even now to people, men and women alike, and even children, that he wants us to rise up in the authority that he has given us, each one, to take that war club, to take that battle axe in your hand and do damage to the enemy. Do not let him steal our children. Do not let him carry on with abortion. murder and injustice, all these things. God wants to use you and he wants to use me. He wants to develop our character so we can go forth boldly and do exploits for him. Have that war club in your hand. See the enemy, and with Jesus coming to your aid, see the enemy put to flight. Isn't that it? I don't know. That is what's been burning in my heart. I'm like a, it's my hobby horse. I can't help it because I know that this is where I'm at the moment. Everything kind of ends up this way. How God wants us to be strong. How he wants us to go out and bind up the brokenhearted. To give sight to the blind. To set the captives free. That is our commission, to go and do those things. Often as women, we sometimes just don't want to be bothered to persevere. It's true, isn't it? Let's be honest. Let's be honest. We do not want to persevere. We'd rather just think, well, if that's the way they're going to go, well, I'm going to dig my hairy little toe in too, and I'm not going to be bothered either. As I say, I have got a Scots heritage, and it does make me a little bit more stubborn than some, but I believe if we're all honest, we've all been there, men and women alike, when we will not give an inch because the other hasn't given an inch. We can use all types of excuses as women. We don't have to. We can be just plain, downright mean at times, use our femininity against others. I've been there and I've done that. Especially around that time of the month. You know what I'm saying? And I tell you something, I used to use that regularly, monthly, as an excuse to be an absolute bear. Until God spoke to me one day and said, you don't need to be like that. Recognize that at that time your hormones are going a bit funny. And at that time you need a bit more sleep. And at that time you perhaps need vitamins. And at that time you may need a little bit of extra tender loving care. You see, I believe that my God is such a practical God. He's not just all spiritual. I'm reminded of Jesus when he did this most earth-shattering thing. He raised a little girl from the dead, didn't he? How wonderful. How marvelous. I think if most of us had been there, we would have called a prayer meeting instantly to praise and worship God and thank him. But Jesus didn't do that. What did he do? He said, give us something to eat. He saw the practical need, you see. And I see it at that particular time in our monthly cycle, whatever, that is a time that the enemy for woman will get in most and try and damage our character. But if you realize that, you know, be sensible, eat well, as Jayne was saying, look after yourself, don't overcommit yourself. That's how I learnt with myself. I thought, right, even to the point of being just a wee bit rude, I would not overcommit myself. So I just had that little bit of extra rest. But you see, before that, I just felt it was my absolute right to be a proper little horror. And I caused damage. I was awful, ladies. I was awful. I really was. And I'm so ashamed of that today. But I don't believe that we should use that as an excuse. I believe we can rise even above that. That's a challenge. That's a challenge to us, each one. We feel it's our right to be perfectly rotten if we want to be. There's a quote from a man called H.L. Mencken, and it says this: there's always an easy solution to every human problem. There's always an easy solution. Neat, plausible, but wrong. You know? It can sound so good. It can look so right. We can have all the excuses backing us up. But God says it's wrong. You see, we're not to go the way that the world goes. We're different. We've got to realize that. We've got to go the way. We've got to have those attitudes. We've got to have that character of God coming through our lives and saying, Lord, everything in me wants to run that way, Lord. Everything. But Father, I choose to go that way. Even though I'm going to get slapped around perhaps for doing it. I don't mean physically. But you know what I mean? Bit of flack. But Father, I so much want to have your attitudes, your, I heard once, you know how it says about the beautiful attitudes? I'm sorry, the attitudes. Beatitudes. I gave the punchline away. Never mind. How it says about the Beatitudes. That's Irish. You see my Irish coming at me and doing it back to front. But but you see, well, I believe that word should be beautiful attitudes, you see. And that leaves a beautiful perfume behind as we walk through this life. People have got to see that we're different. Rona was saying that last night. Jayne's been saying it. People have got to see that we're different. And a little saying that I've heard, one in the eye is worth a thousand in the ear. One in the eye is worth a thousand in the ear. And you can go along to that unsaved friend and you can pound them and pound them and pound them about how, why they need Jesus, and they see your life in disorder and they see your character unlovely. And what do they say? You see, they're seeing, they're not looking to hear. No, that's not right. What is that? My husband does it right. They're not looking to see, but they're looking to hear. No, that's not right. Doesn't matter. I might think of that a bit later on. But they want to see our very lives. Not so much what we say, but what we are. And that's the beautiful character that Jesus is going to develop in our lives as we persevere. As we persevere. I believe that God would have us rise above our situations and begin to realize that we can be overcomers against all odds. I don't want to push my life story at you anymore, but what I'm saying is we can overcome. Even when you think it's just absolutely impossible, if you fix your gaze on Jesus, you will overcome. That's the only way. And my grieving really started when our first son was born. Because you see, everything in you, when you bring forth a child, you want it to be so right. And that little boy, everything was so wrong. I'm pleased to say today that he's 23 years of age and he's been filled with the Spirit, baptized in water. And he's a joy and a delight. He puts our worship to shame. The other morning I said, come on, Marky. I said, I'm going on the beach for a walk to worship Jesus. Okay, Jan. He calls me Jan. And okay, Jan, he says in this beautiful rough voice. So we got the dog, Spencer, and we started to walk along the beach. And the beach was deserted, which was quite fortunate. And I began to worship the Lord. I'm sure, actually, there's so many Christians down that way. And if people have got binoculars, they see these people talking to themselves, pacing up and down the beach. And I just heard Dale, how Dave goes to the high places at least once or twice a day in the city and prays. And Jayne saw him out there the other morning with his hands raised. Praise God for people like that who are willing to stand up and be counted and made fools for Jesus Christ. Anyway, so Marky came along with me to the beach. It might look foolish to the outward, but it's not foolish to God, because things are happening in the heavenlies, believe you me, in this country. And so Marky's a little bit slow in walking, so I kind of went on a wee bit ahead, and I turned around at one stage to see how far he was. And there he was behind me, about 12 paces behind, with his hands up, glory to you, Jesus. Oh, Jesus, he can't talk very well. But praising God. I tell you what, he's prayed for people and people haven't even been able to understand what he said and people have been healed. Isn't that neat? You see, God doesn't look on what we're saying, what we look like. It's what is coming from our hearts, what is coming from our spirit. So as I said last night, don't you dare think that you've even got the slightest little bit of excuse why God wouldn't want to use you or why you'd be inadequate. If he can use a handicapped young man, he can certainly use you and me. Isn't that true? All you've got to be is available. Okay. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Verses 3 to 5. For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons that we fight with are not weapons of this world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. And we take captive every thought and make it obedient to Christ. I know the biggest problem for women is here. Please say amen.
Amen.
Fine, it's here. But what does God say? He said, don't you battle it out on the natural. Don't take up natural carnal weapons. In other words, perhaps our tongue or our attitudes or our withholding. But he says, you take up the weapons that I have given you to destroy, to tear down those strongholds and to take hold of those thoughts as they begin to settle in our minds. Take them and make them captive to the obedience of Christ. I had to persevere, see this word persevere, for 6 months for one whole. This was before my son died. It was another area of real deep grief I was going through. And I tell you something, I had to persevere for 6 months until I finally broke through. At times I felt I was going mad. I said, God, I'm going mad. These thoughts were just literally, it was a morning to night bombardment on my mind in this particular area. I had chosen to forgive. I had made that choice. But my whole emotional area needed healing. The whole emotional area had just been torn out and ripped up. I had a crushed spirit. And I tell you what, the devil capitalizes on circumstances. He capitalizes on crushed, broken hearts. Yes, that's right. They did do that to you, didn't they? Yes, that's right. And he pours that poison. But I say to you, if you have chosen to forgive, you remind the devil that. And I was doing that day in and day out. I said, devil, I have chosen to forgive. My emotions still haven't come in line with what my spirit has chosen to do, but I have chosen to forgive. I continue to bless that person. I continue to bless those people. I refuse to let bitterness have dominion over me. What was I doing? I was taking those thoughts captive. Believe me, dear ones, it was this particular time, the 6 month period, was even harder than the grieving that I've gone through with Davy. But God knew I needed to get that sorted out, because I don't think I could have survived what was ahead. 6 months later, we lost David, you see. But he allowed me to be whole, as Jayne was saying, to be a whole person. My character was developing. It was through adversity, but through that, by the grace of God and only the grace of God alone, he's given me that stickability to persevere. My hope began to come again, you see, and that's how the character develops. I'll be honest with you, adversity does not do much for your faith. Losing a child does not do much for your faith. I'm being absolutely honest. It can shatter you if you haven't got that hope in your heart. But what it does, as you persevere and you hang on to God with all your might, it brings that character. It, as I say, might not be 5'10" tall and gracious, but you see, it's what God is doing on the inside of me and what God is doing on the inside of you. It's that beautiful inner beauty that he is so vitally concerned about, not what we look like on the outside. It reminds me of Lynn Ravenhill. He went to pray. I forget who the other man was. I think it might have been Duncan Campbell. And he went to pray with this old woman of God, a real prayer warrior. And that's something I want to become, a prayer warrior. Anyway, this Duncan Campbell, he warned Lynn Ravenhill. He said, now when you go, he said, this woman will say to you, gentlemen, do you want tea? And he said, just say yes. Just say yes. So he said, okay. And then she'll say, shall we pray? And he warned them that she had a real gruff voice, you see. And he said, just drop to your knees and we'll pray. He said, okay, I've got it. Well, Leonard Ravenhill said, nothing prepared me for what met my eyes as I opened the door. He said, I have travelled throughout Africa and I have seen alligators. And he said, I've seen this and I've seen... But he said, nothing prepared me for this woman as I saw her. You may not... He said... Now, this was not my words. He said, she was the ugliest woman I have ever seen. He said, she was so ugly. And she said, gentlemen, will you have tea? And they said, yes, please. So they sat down, they had tea. And when I say tea, that's a cup of tea. You see, it was England. And then she said, let us pray. And they dropped to their knees. And you know, that man said, she opened her mouth and began to pray. And he said, within 1 minute, I didn't know whether I was on earth or in heaven. You see, the beauty, that character, that loveliness of God, that preciousness was in her spirit, and just beauty irradiated out of her life. Isn't that neat? Okay, so back to 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 to 5. Some examples, these fiery darts that the enemy can throw at you. Somebody's ignoring you. Did you see that, sister? She walked right past you. She never even acknowledged. That's it. Look, she's going down to talk to so-and-so, but look, you're nobody anyway. Now, I'm going to ask for a raise of hands. Who's ever had those thoughts? Isn't that amazing? You see, he's the same old devil, and he's just like a broken record. He uses the same thing over and over again. But the sad part about it, ladies, we listen to it. I challenge you every morning when you get up, you clothe yourself with that whole armor of God. Clothe yourself with that whole armor of God. You think you're no good. You're useless. You couldn't possibly be like so-and-so. I remember at one stage in my life, I couldn't even imagine that anybody would ever want to even come to my house to visit because I felt so unworthy. I thought, who are you? You haven't even got anything to offer anybody. Tell you what, those are lies. I've come to realize that I am beautiful. And this is not saying it in a proud way. I've come to realize that my God in me is lovely. And it's the most releasing, liberating feeling. Talk about woman's lib. It's got nothing on it. When you know who you are in God and what God is within you, it's wonderful. It's beautiful. We can overcome Satan by how? Revelation 12, 10 to 11 shows us how to do this. Hands up those who know the scripture before we even turn to it. Great, that's good. Excellent. They overcome Satan by what? The blood of the Lamb. They overcome him by the blood of the Lamb. It says here, Now have come salvation and the power of the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. For the accuser of our brothers who accuses them before God day and night. He doesn't stop. He's always accusing. But they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. And they did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. And sisters, I believe that some of us are even going to die for Jesus. I believe that with all my heart. I believe that with all my heart. And let us not shrink back. Let us not shrink back from what God wants to do in your heart and life. We're going to turn over now to 1 Samuel chapter 17. 1 Samuel chapter 17. I know you've all, especially if you're a Sunday school teacher or a Bible school teacher, you probably know this story backwards, but we're going to go over it again because I believe it's a beautiful parallel between the children of God today and the enemy of our souls. And it says here, we're going to read from, just to give you a wee bit of background, that Jesse got David, the youngest of the family. He said, now go and see how your brothers are doing in the war. Quite unusual, isn't it? Just sort of pack them up with a lunch and send them over to see how the war's going. But that's how they did it in those days. And so David left. He obeyed and he went. And he ran to the battle lines and he greeted his brothers. And as he was talking with his brothers, Goliath, the Philistine champion from Garth, he stepped out from his lines and shouted his, look at this word, his, if you've got your Bibles, can you read it through with me? Because you just, there's some little words I really want to pick out. And he shouted his usual defiance, and David heard it. Now, when the Israelites saw the man, they all ran from him in great fear. Now, let me just paint the picture here. David was just a shepherd boy. He was the youngest of all his brothers. I would imagine, I may be wrong, but I would imagine he'd be in his early teens. And his brothers would have probably been in their 20s, perhaps even in their 30s. Now, you know, it's interesting. These brothers had been, they were in this battle, and they came, the Philistines were on that side, the Israelites were on that side, and there was a valley between them. They came out each morning prepared for battle. Now, I'm sure that those Israelites, they just didn't come out in their under tunics. They were dressed. You see, the sad part about it, they looked the part. They were dressed for battle. They looked the part, but they did nothing about it. And then this great big Goliath came out and he shouted his usual defiance. And David heard it. When the Israelites saw the man, they all ran away from him in great fear. Now the Israelites had been saying, do you see how this man keeps coming out? He comes out to defy Israel, the king. The king will give great wealth to the man who kills him. He will also give him his daughter in marriage and will exempt his father family from taxes in Israel. That would be neat, eh? They'd not have to pay taxes. David asked the men standing near him, he said, what will be done for the man who kills this Philistine and removes this disgrace from Israel? He was a disgrace. Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God? Who is he? That's what God is saying to you. Get your eyes up and realize you're not fighting each other. You're fighting the enemy of your soul. They repeated to him what they'd been saying and told him, this is what's going to be done for the man who kills him. When Eliab, David's oldest brother, heard him speaking with the men, he burned with anger at David. You see, here was David. He had the Spirit of God in his life. And he could see that this great big overgrown giant was defying God. And his brother was so angry that David dared say that. But it was the truth. And I believe as you go out and you speak in truth, you are going to have your brothers and your sisters sometimes not understanding where you're coming from. But press on. And he burned with anger and he said, why have you come down here? And with whom did you leave those few sheep in the desert? I know how conceited you are and how wicked your heart is. You have only come down to watch the battle. Now, what have I done? Said David. Can't I even speak? And then he turned around and he began to speak to the other men about it. And then David was overheard, and it was reported to Saul, and Saul, the king, sent to him. And Saul, David said to Saul, let no one lose heart. You see, remember that word hope? When we've got no perseverance, we have no hope. Let no one lose heart on account of this Philistine. Your servant will go and fight him. Saul replied, you're not able to go and fight against this Philistine. You're only a boy, and he's been a fighting man from his youth. But David said to Saul, he said, your servant has been keeping his father's sheep. When a lion and a bear came and carried off a sheep from the flock, I went after it, and I struck it, and I rescued the sheep from its mouth. When it turned on me, I seized it. And I've seized it by its hair, and I struck it, and I killed it. Your servant has killed both the lion and the bear. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, because he has defied the armies of the living God. Please put it into everyday life, ladies, as I'm speaking through. The Lord who delivered me from the poor. You see, David realized that it wasn't anything on his behalf. He realized it was God in him. The Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. Saul said to David, go and the Lord be with you. And as you go, the peace of God is going to go with you too, ladies. As you go, as you step out and you be bold for God, he's going to be with you. But it says, as you go, you've got to go. You've just got to go. And then you'll find that peace and that boldness will follow you. Then Saul, he dressed David in his own tunic. The weapons of our warfare, they're not carnal, are they? See, Saul thought, I'll help this young guy out, which was probably just on the natural. He tried to help him out. But David said, this is no good. I can't even move in this. You see, he was not going to fight in the natural. He said, I can't go in these because I'm not used to them. So he took them off. Then he took his staff in his hand and he chose 5 smooth stones from the stream and he put them in his pouch and his sling in his hand and he approached the Philistine. Now meanwhile, the Philistine, he kept, and his shield bearer in front of him, kept coming closer to David. Have you ever had that giant that just keeps coming closer and closer? You just about have eyeball-eyeball confrontation. David looked over, and he looked over David, and he saw that he was only a boy, and he despised him. Sisters, recognize this fact. The devil hates you. He's out to rob you. He's out to destroy you, and he's out to kill you. He said to David, am I a dog that you come to me with sticks? And the Philistines cursed David by his dogs. Come here, he said, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and to the beasts of the field. Now, what I want to encourage you is this. When the devil comes at you like a roaring lion, he's like a roaring lion. He is not a roaring lion. You have the lion of Judah within you. Remember that. So when he comes at you like a roaring lion, you bounce back with the truth. So David said, you come to me with a sword and a spear and a javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will hand you over to me, and I will strike you down and I'll cut off your head. Today I will give the carcasses of the Philistine army to the birds of the air and the beasts of the field. You see, David turned it right round. He said, David, what you've said to me, God is going to do to you. All those that gathered here will know that it is not by sword, it is not by spear as the Lord saves, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give all into our hands. Now the Philistine, he moved closer to attack him. What did David do? You look at verse 48. Halfway through verse 48, David stood there and he kind of said, where is somebody? Come on, hold up a shield in front of me. Did he do that? The Bible says that David ran quickly towards the battle line to meet him. And sisters, this is what's on my heart this weekend, that you will run to that battle line with that battle axe in your hand, you see? With that war club that God has given in your hand to set the captives free, to plunder the gates of hell, to plunder hell, to tear open those gates that said will not prevail against God's children. The gates of hell will not prevail against God's people. You see, you run at those circumstances. Run at them. Don't run away any longer. You can do it because it's not you, it's God working in you. And so David, he ran to the battle line to meet him. Reaching into his bag, he took out a stone and he slung it and struck the Philistine on the forehead. That was the only part that wasn't covered on that great big giant. Do you know, it reminds me that when we clothe ourselves with the whole armor of God in the morning, I do that every day, as we clothe ourselves with that whole armor of God and we go out to do battle against the enemy, do you realize something? When we use the shield of faith and we use that sword of the Spirit, he's standing there and he's got no armor at all. Isn't that exciting? He's got no armor at all because he's been stripped of it. Hasn't he? He's been stripped of every bit of authority. But God has given you and me that authority to do damage. So David triumphed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone. Without a sword in his hand, he struck down the Philistine and he killed him. And they won a great battle that day. Verse 25. I'm going to pick out these verses. The Israelites were in great fear. They ran away. Don't run away. Stand your ground. If you don't feel you've got the courage or the perseverance to stand your ground, we're going to pray for you very soon. We're going to get you to come out and we're going to pray that the very courage, the tenacity, the perseverance of God is going to be in your life. Don't run away. It's fun to fight. I used to run away and it did me so much damage. The more you run away and the more you listen to the devil's lies, the more he pours in the poison. He never ever thinks, well, Jan's had a bit of a rough deal this week. I think I'll just lay off a bit. He doesn't do it when you're downest the most. He puts the boot in. Because he's out to rob you and he's out to kill you. But rise up against that, my dear sisters. Rise up against that. Don't let him lay a blow on you. You lay the first blow. It says in the Word of God that in Psalm, I think it's 144, and I don't quite know the verse, it is God who trains our hands to war. Let's just quickly turn to that. I think, if anybody can find that before me, that'd be wonderful. I think it's 144. Is it in 144? Is that the right one? Pardon? Ah, verse 1. Okay. Praise be to the Lord my rock, who trains my hands to war, my fingers for battle. He is my loving God and my fortress, my stronghold, and he's my deliverer, my shield, in whom I take refuge. Read that whole psalm. It'll just thrill you. David recognized, verse 26, David recognized that Goliath was defying God. Recognize. When people set themselves up against the Most High God, when those thoughts pour into your mind, reckon and say, hey, that's not what my God says about the situation. I honestly, what Trevor and I are really doing at the moment, what God has laid on our heart, is when we, if we go into an area and we sense this disunity, we go all out for unity. If we sense there's a spirit of unrest, we pray in peace. If we sense there's a spirit of sadness, we pray joy. Whatever you find the opposite, just whatever you find the situation against you, go for the opposite. If you find there's something, a stinginess, be generous. You see, it works. Verse 32, he wanted to fight Goliath because he knew that he wasn't trusting in his little slingshot. He was trusting in God. Verse 33, discouragement. Saul discouraged Saul. He said, he reminded David that he was just a boy. And you're going to have times when you're just going to be discouraged, and he's going to remind you, who on earth do you think you are? You think you can possibly do damage? You're joking. You're only a little old lady. You're only a little girl. That's the lie. Never, ever listen to what he says. Always listen to what God's got to say, because he is the way, the truth, and the life. Verses 34 to 37, David told Saul how God had helped him with battles before, so he had that confidence. But you see, dear ones, as I say, when you get that, when the adversity builds, where is it on the front of it again? Adversity builds character and Christ-likeness. As we go through these things, looking into the face of Jesus, holding onto his hand, he's going to give us the battle strategy. He will. Verses 38 to 39, the armor was a hindrance to David. Now, I'm not talking about the armor of God. I'm talking about those with the natural things. It was a hindrance to David. Don't rely on the world's methods. If people come against you with accusations, don't you dare come back at them with accusations. Leave it to God. He's the vindicator. But, you know, there's something about women. We want to have the last say, don't we? And we just want to come out on top, put our cause, and that's an area that God has to deal with me continually. I'm learning to leave things with God. The battle is not mine, it's God's. Rely on God and his word. Verses 41 to 47, threats are thrown at David. He keeps reminding Goliath that he is defying the living God. If the devil keeps reminding you of your past, what you've done, and what you haven't done, you remind him of his future. And what is his future? He is condemned to the everlasting fire, isn't he? When he reminds you of your past continually, you say, no, hang on a minute. You see, I'm taking these thoughts captive, you see. Hang on a minute. That's not, you see, honestly, if anybody looked in my bathroom or my bedroom at times, I'd think I was really quite funny, but this is what I do. I say, that is not what my God says about me. You see, you're taking those thoughts captive, you're bringing them into the obedience of Christ. And you see, and you just come out, you speak out, you run at that with the word of God, with the truth of God. And verses 48 to 50 is this. As Goliath approached David, as Goliath approached, as he kept coming, David, he ran to meet him. Run. Don't worry about the threats or the opposition that keeps coming against you. Run. Run to meet that giant. Remember, the Bible says that when the enemy comes in like a flood, God is going to lift up a standard against him. Isn't that neat? You have got God fighting for you. Now, what I want you to do now, I'm going to pray, and then as you respond to that prayer, we're going to have ladies come and pray. This is the area that I really want you that I sort of want to major on, if you like, is the area, if you feeling a tug from God to do something for him, that you just feel there's a little bit of a stirring from God and you're just not quite sure which way to go. The devil said to you, who on earth do you think you are, Mrs. Big? You know, I've had all that. All God wants from you today, what I want you to say in your heart is, here I am, Lord, totally available to you. Lord, I want to use you to use me in your kingdom. Father, I know it's not by my might or power, but it's by your Spirit. And if you've got that tug in your heart, if you want more perseverance, if you want to be a battle axe for God, remember, for God, never be a battle axe in any other area, but be a battle axe, you know, so you can plunder the gates of hell. You can drive back the enemy. See those hurting, bruised ones, as the ladies have been talking about, binding up the broken hearts, setting the captives free. If you desire that in your life, I want you to come forward, and the ladies are going to pray for you, and reach out to God, and believe that there's going to be an impartation, one, of boldness, of stickability, of perseverance, and then that God will birth a vision in your heart and give you clear direction in your hearts and lives. Let's pray. Father, we just lift you up on the highest place. And we thank you, Father, that everything in this precious word is for us. And Father, we thank you that there is nothing, no weapon that's formed against us is going to prosper. Father, we thank you, Lord, that when we go out and do battle with the enemy, that you're there right with us and you have equipped us for battle. Father, you said that you've trained our hands to war. And we thank you for that, Father. And we pray, Lord, as these people respond, that, Father, you'll birth insight, you'll birth courage, you'll birth perseverance, tenacity, stickability. But then, Father God, you'll begin to stir up the gifts that you've placed, those talents that you've placed in their lives, that they've been hanging on to, and the devil's been saying, you're just not good enough. Father, that's a lie. And right now, we just break that lie and the power of that lie in the name of Jesus Christ. We rebuke you, devil, and we resist those lies in the name of Jesus. How dare you lie to God's children? We will not allow it one second longer. We take captive those thoughts. Spirit of God, you come now. You have your way. And you speak and teach these women things to come. As only you can, you begin to speak into their hearts the things that you would have them do. In the mighty name of our Savior and Lord, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Please.
Jan and her husband run the Trustees of Lifeway Ministries. They are the trustees, is that right?
That's right?
Of Lifeway Ministries, Lifeway Bible School. Trevor and Jan are national coordinators for Rise Up Together New Zealand. Isn't that a wonderful title? I've been hearing what they're doing throughout New Zealand, and it's the best thing I've ever heard of for a long, long time. They've put out this magazine, Rise Up Together New Zealand. Remember the Together New Zealand. Pick one up, look through it. They've also got a video available, and if you would like a copy of it, there's a phone number on the back page, and any other material, if you give them a buzz, you'll have it sent to you. Well, bless you. We're going to have a mighty time with Jan.
Do you know, when I was growing up, I wish I was Jayne. If it'd been like that, I wanted to be taller. I wanted straight hair, not curls all over the place. And I wanted to be a lady. But unfortunately, God's given me a personality. Well, first of all, I'm short. And I've got curly hair. And he's made me a tomboy. And my mother used to despair with me. I'd be climbing trees and whistling to the boys down the road. They were my cousins. We grew up. We built tree houses, cowboys and Indians. I used to love the dolls too. My mother used to just shake her head in despair and ever wonder whether I'm going to ever turn out to be a lady. Well, you know something? I have. But I'm me. And I think that what God is going to say this weekend, that you are uniquely you. Don't try and be something that you're not. I tried that for a while. I tried to be quiet. And I tried to be elegant. And I tried to be ever so gracious. And I was an absolute pain to everybody around. Of course, none of you ladies would be like that, would you? But God said to me one day, I love you for who you are. And I've created you for my pleasure. And so therefore I've created you just as I want you. I mean, if we were all of the one kind, I guess it'd be pretty boring, wouldn't it? It would be a pretty boring sort of life. And as I often keep reminding my husband, well, honey, with my temperament, you see, I'm mainly Scots. I have some Irish in me, plus a little bit of French and Norwegian. The Irish and the Scots personality makes life interesting, believe you me. And so I say to my husband, well, it keeps you on your toes. But before we start, let's pray. Father, we thank you for your presence here. We thank you for your anointing of your Holy Spirit in this place. And we thank you, Father, that we're here by divine appointment, each one of us. That, Father, you're speaking into our hearts. And that, Father, that things are going to be birthed in ladies' spirits this weekend. Things, Lord, that they'd never dreamed possible. But, Father, you're going to put your hand upon them and say, that my daughter, this is what I'd have you do. Obey what I'm saying to you, then take the next step, then obey, and then step on again. So, Father, we just once again say we are totally available for you to do whatever you want to do. We welcome your presence, Holy Spirit. And we thank you, Father, for Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. Well, I was given the topic of character and emotions, and when Pat gave me that, I thought, boy, that's really for me, because if anybody's been an emotional type, it's been me. And as I said last night, I've had lots happen, lots has come my way. And it really, the things that we've gone through as a family, just very, very briefly, my first son was born Down syndrome. He's mentally handicapped. My second son, we nearly lost him at birth. He died at 16 and a half years of age. My third child, Rebecca, well, everything went perfectly for her. But you know, in that accident I was just sharing very briefly last night, we nearly lost our daughter too. Plus many, many other things. But through it all, I have learned to trust in Jesus Christ. And that's what I was trying to say last night, is the things that come against your life, the roads that God asks you to walk down sometime, leave behind pools of refreshing so that others can be refreshed. Don't leave behind bitter waters. Because you see, not only does it affect you, but it really does affect everybody else around you. So let's purpose in our hearts, as precious women of God, that wherever we go, we're going to leave a beautiful fragrance behind us. Not a horrible smell, but a beautiful fragrance of Jesus Christ. Obviously, sometimes we've all read books and heard sermons regarding women's emotions, their temperaments, their sexuality, etc. But the area that I want to cover is, what do we do with our emotions? Do we use them for us or against us? Do we use them for us or against us? A quote that I heard just recently was this: what we are is a gift from God. What we can become is our gift to God. I'm going to repeat that. What we are is a gift from God. What we can become is our gift to God. Isn't that true? And I don't know about you, but I've got a longing and a hunger in my heart to make my life worthy for Jesus. It's a hunger. And I once heard somebody say, "Oh God, fill me with an unsatisfied satisfaction for you." In other words, and I believe that's what we should be like, ladies. Always going on to fresh things, always seeking more things in God. Don't ever get to that place where you sit there and think, "Well, Lord, I've arrived. I'm extremely comfortable, God. I don't want to go any further." And I tell you something, we can pray that prayer. And God will say, "Okay, if that's how you want it." But I believe that each one of us, God would have us stir ourselves and keep pressing on, keep pressing on. Don't you think that? Don't you? Isn't that the desire of your heart? I trust it is as this weekend goes on. The dictionary definition of character is this: the combination of qualities or features that distinguishes one person or group from another. The dictionary definition of emotions is this: any strong feeling as of joy, sorrow, reverence, hate, or love, arising subjectively rather than through conscious mental effort. We don't sort of wake up in the morning and think, "Right, today, God, I'm going to be joyful. Today, I'm going to have a reverence in my heart." We can say those things, but we don't consciously start the day off and think, "I'm going to be this way." Things trigger us off. I mean, we might start off good, but as Jayne was saying, she was washing her dishes at 6 o'clock this morning from last night, and things don't always go sweet like you see on TV around breakfast time, do they, ladies? Doesn't round our household, and so that can set the tone for the day for a woman. It can really set the tone for the day, but it's what we do with it, whether it continues on that way or not. I remember once Rebecca and this young man that was boarding at our house, I don't know what happened this particular night, but they were at each other's throats. Now, they were really good friends, but they were at each other's throats. And I took them dinner, and look, honestly, they were just like, they were pecking at each other. It was awful. And I just said to them, "Look, hang on a minute, guys." I said, "Do you see what you're doing to each other?" And they sort of said, "What?" And I said, you're picking on each other. Why is it?" And they said, "We don't know." So right then and there, I took authority over a spirit of contention. And I said, "Give me your hands, we're going to pray." And they, you know what teenagers are like, you know, but I was forceful. And I said, "Give me your hands, we are going to pray. Because I know that's not really how you feel in your heart. And it's a real contentious thing that's trying to come in. Let's do away with it." And so we joined hands and we prayed, they prayed, and it went just like that. And I believe, you see, that's the authority that God has given to us, each one, to cut down the forces of evil, the onslaught that come against us. We're going to speak about that more often. But, you know, more a bit later on. But the peace of God came back in that house. But, you see, as women, I think that we have that as the mothers, and we spend most of the time with the children. We have within our hands that ability to tear down or to build up. Isn't that true? Let's be builders. So let's take authority over those things that you see them coming in, and let's be peacemakers in our home. I believe that adversity builds character and Christ-likeness. And in my notes, I've written it like this: adversity builds character and Christ-likeness. It's a progression that's going up and up and up. And you might say, adversity. Nobody really likes to speak about that today. Pain and suffering. But wherever I go, that's what I hear most about. Isn't that true? But you see, and because we're Christians, it doesn't mean to say that we're exempt from it either. I haven't found that so. But as I say, it's what we do with it. As it comes our way, what do we do with it? Let's turn to Romans chapter 5 from verses 3 and 4. Romans chapter 5, verses 1 to 4, especially verses 3 and 4. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also rejoice in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit whom he has given us. Isn't that a beautiful scripture? When suffering produces perseverance, perseverance, character, and character, hope. What happens if we turn that formula around and we reverse this formula that we've just spoken about? If we lack hope, I believe it's because we lack character. If we lack character, I believe it's because we lack perseverance. And if we lack perseverance, it is because we have not responded properly to the trials and tribulations that we all face. I'm going to say that again, because I believe it's so true. If we find we lack hope, it's because we lack character. If we lack character, it is because we lack perseverance. And if we lack perseverance, it is because we have not responded properly to the trials and tribulations that we all face. I particularly want to emphasize perseverance for you, woman. I know in my life, up to the last 4 years, I didn't persevere hardly at all. I let everything wash over me. Everything that came my way, I just kind of took it and let all these things wash over me. But in the last 4 years, I've learned something. I've learned that God wants us to arise and to be bold, to be vital, to be strong, to be woman of backbone, to be woman of character, to be woman of grit, to have that steel in your backbone. No matter what comes your way, you are going to stand. And having done all, you're going to stand. Do you know that you can be a battle axe for God? This is in the right sense. Do you know that you can be a battle axe for God? Now, I don't mean a battle axe, ladies. And I guess we've all been there at some time. But listen to this. In Jeremiah 51, verse 20. Jeremiah 51, verse 20. I heard this on a video once and it just excited me. Because I thought, great, there's an excuse to be a battle axe, but in the right way. And it says in the NIV, it says, "You are my war club." My war club, or my battle axe, my weapon for battle. So it's okay to be a battle axe, okay? With you, I shatter nations. With you, I destroy kingdoms. With you, I shatter horse and rider. With you, I shatter chariot and driver. And so on. You read that the rest of those verses. But what God is saying here, and I believe what God is saying throughout this nation, even now to people, men and women alike, and even children, that he wants us to rise up in the authority that he has given us each one, to take that war club, to take that battle axe in your hand and do damage to the enemy. Do not let him steal our children. Do not let him carry on with abortion, murder, injustice, all these things. God wants to use you and he wants to use me. He wants to develop our character so we can go forth boldly and do exploits for him. Have that war club in your hand. See the enemy and with Jesus coming to your aid, see the enemy put to flight. Isn't that it? I don't know. That is what's been burning in my heart. I'm like it's my hobby horse. I can't help it because I know that this is where I'm at the moment. Everything kind of ends up this way. How God wants us to be strong. How he wants us to go out and bind up the brokenhearted. To give sight to the blind. To set the captives free. That is our commission, to go and do those things. Often as women, we sometimes just don't want to be bothered to persevere. It's true, isn't it? Let's be honest. We do not want to persevere. We'd rather just think, well, if that's the way they're going to go, well, I'm going to dig my hairy little toe in too, and I'm not going to be bothered either. As I say, I have got a Scots heritage, and it does make me a little bit more stubborn than some, but I believe if we're all honest, we've all been there, men and women alike, when we will not give an inch because the other hasn't given an inch. We can use all types of excuses as women. We don't have to. We can be just plain, downright mean at times, use our femininity against others. I've been there and I've done that. Especially around that time of the month. You know what I'm saying? And I tell you something, I used to use that regularly, monthly, as an excuse to be an absolute bear. Until God spoke to me one day and said, you don't need to be like that. Recognize that at that time your hormones are going a bit funny. And at that time you need a bit more sleep. And at that time you perhaps need vitamins. And in that time you may need a little bit of extra tender loving care. You see, I believe that my God is such a practical God. He's not just all spiritual. I'm reminded of Jesus when he did this most earth-shattering thing. He raised a little girl from the dead, didn't he? How wonderful. How marvelous. I think if most of us had been there, we would have called a prayer meeting instantly to praise and worship God and thank him. But Jesus didn't do that. What did he do? He said, give us something to eat. He saw the practical need, you see. And I see it at that particular time in our monthly cycle, whatever, that is a time that the enemy for woman will get in most and try and damage our character. But if you realize that, you know, be sensible, eat well, as Jane was saying, look after yourself, don't overcommit yourself. That's how I learnt with myself. I thought, right, even to the point of being just a wee bit rude, I would not overcommit myself. So I just had that little bit of extra rest. But you see, before that, I just felt it was my absolute right to be a proper little horror. And I caused damage. I was awful, ladies. I was awful. I really was. And I'm so ashamed of that today. But I don't believe that we should use that as an excuse. I believe we can rise even above that. That's a challenge. That's a challenge to us, each one. We feel it's our right to be perfectly rotten if we want to be. There's a quote from a man called H.L. Mencken, and it says this: there's always an easy solution to every human problem. There's always an easy solution. Neat, plausible, but wrong. You know? It can sound so good, it can look so right. We can have all the excuses backing us up, but God says it's wrong. You see, we're not to go the way that the world goes. We're different. We've got to realize that. We've got to go the way. We've got to have those attitudes. We've got to have that character of God coming through our lives and saying, Lord, everything in me wants to run that way, Lord. Everything. But Father, I choose to go that way. Even though I'm going to get slapped around perhaps for doing it. I don't mean physically. But you know what I mean? Bit of flack. But Father, I so much want to have your attitudes. I heard once, you know how it says about the beautiful attitudes. Beatitudes. I gave the punchline away. Never mind. How it says about the Beatitudes. That's Irish. You see my Irish coming at me and doing it back to front. But you see, what I believe that word should be beautiful attitudes, you see. And that leaves a beautiful perfume behind as we walk through this life. People have got to see that we're different. Rona was saying that last night. Jayne's been saying it. People have got to see that we're different. And a little saying that I've heard, one in the eye is worth a thousand in the ear. One in the eye is worth a thousand in the ear. And you can go along to that unsaved friend. And you can pound them and pound them and pound them about how why they need Jesus, and they see your life in disorder. And they see your character unlovely. And what do they say? You see, they're seeing. They're not looking to hear. No, that's not right. What is that? My husband does it wrong. They're not looking to see, but they're looking to hear. No, that's not right. Doesn't matter. I might think of that a bit later on. But they want to see our very lives. Not so much what we say, but what we are. And that's the beautiful character that Jesus is going to develop in our lives as we persevere. As we persevere. I believe that God would have us rise above our situations and begin to realize that we can be overcomers against all odds. I don't want to push my life story at you anymore, but what I'm saying is we can overcome. Even when you think it's just absolutely impossible, if you fix your gaze on Jesus, you will overcome. That's the only way. And my grieving really started when our first son was born. Because you see, everything in you, when you bring forth a child, you want it to be so right. And that little boy, everything was so wrong. I'm pleased to say today that he's 23 years of age and he's been filled with the Spirit, baptized in water, and he's a joy and a delight. He puts our worship to shame. The other morning I said, come on, Marky. I said, I'm going on the beach for a walk to worship Jesus. Okay, Jan. He calls me Jan. And okay, Jan, he says in this beautiful rough voice. So we got the dog, Spencer, and we started to walk along the beach, and the beach was deserted, which was quite fortunate. And I began to worship the Lord. I'm sure, actually, there's so many Christians down that way. And if people have got binoculars, they see these people talking to themselves, pacing up and down the beach. And I just heard Dale, how Dave goes to the high places at least once or twice a day in the city and prays. And Jayne saw him out there the other morning with his hands raised. Praise God for people like that who are willing to stand up and be counted and made fools for Jesus Christ. Anyway, so Marky came along with me to the beach. It might look foolish to the outward, but it's not foolish to God, because things are happening in the heavenlies, believe you me, in this country. And so Marky's a little bit slow in walking, so I kind of went on a wee bit ahead, and I turned around at one stage to see how far he was, and there he was behind me, about 12 paces behind, with his hands up, glory to you, Jesus. Oh, Jesus, he can't talk very well. But praising God. I tell you what, he's prayed for people and people haven't even been able to understand what he said and people have been healed. Isn't that neat? You see, God doesn't look on what we're saying, what we look like. It's what is coming from our hearts, what is coming from our spirit. So as I said last night, don't you dare think that you've even got the slightest little bit of excuse why God wouldn't want to use you or why you'd be inadequate. If he can use a handicapped young man, he can certainly use you and me. Isn't that true? All you've got to be is available. Okay. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Verses 3 to 5. For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons that we fight with are not weapons of this world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. And we take captive every thought and make it obedient to Christ. I believe, not that I believe, I know the biggest problem for women is here. Please say amen.
Amen.
Fine. It's here. But what does God say? He said, don't you battle it out on the natural. Don't take up natural carnal weapons. In other words, perhaps our tongue or our attitudes or our withholding. But he says, you take up the weapons that I have given you to destroy, to tear down those strongholds and to take hold of those thoughts as they begin to settle in our minds. Take them and make them captive to the obedience of Christ. I had to persevere, see this word persevere, for 6 months, for one whole, this was before my son died. It was another area of real deep grief I was going through. And I tell you something, I had to persevere for 6 months until I finally broke through. At times I felt I was going mad. I said, God, I'm going mad. These thoughts were just literally, it was a morning to night bombardment on my mind in this particular area. I had chosen to forgive. I had made that choice. But my whole emotional area needed healing. The whole emotional area had just been torn out and ripped up. I had a crushed spirit. And I tell you what, the devil capitalizes on circumstances. He capitalizes on crushed, broken hearts. Yes, that's right. They did do that to you, didn't they? Yes, that's right. And he pours that poison. But I say to you, if you have chosen to forgive, you remind the devil that. And I was doing that day in and day out. I said, devil, I have chosen to forgive. My emotions still haven't come in line with what my spirit has chosen to do, but I have chosen to forgive. I continue to bless that person. I continue to bless those people. I refuse to let bitterness have dominion over me. What was I doing? I was taking those thoughts captive. Believe me, dear ones, it was this particular time, this 6 month period, was even harder than the grieving that I've gone through with Davy. But God knew I needed to get that sorted out, because I don't think I could have survived what was ahead. 6 months later, we lost David, you see. But he allowed me to be whole, as Jayne was saying, to be a whole person. My character was developing. It was through adversity, but through that, by the grace of God, and only the grace of God alone, he's given me that stickability to persevere. My hope began to come again, you see, and that's how the character develops. I'll be honest with you, adversity does not do much for your faith. Losing a child does not do much for your faith. I'm being absolutely honest. It can shatter you if you haven't got that hope in your heart. But what it does, as you persevere and you hang on to God with all your might, it brings that character. It, as I say, might not be 5'10" tall and gracious, but you see, it's what God is doing on the inside of me and what God is doing on the inside of you. It's that beautiful inner beauty that he is so vitally concerned about, not what we look like on the outside. It reminds me of Len Ravenhill. He went to pray. I forget who the other man was. I think it might have been Duncan Campbell. And he went to pray with this old woman of God, a real prayer warrior. And that's something I want to become, a prayer warrior. Anyway, this Duncan Campbell, he warned Len Ravenhill. He said, now when you go, he said, this woman will say to you, gentlemen, do you want tea? And he said, just say yes. Just say yes. So he said, okay. And then she'll say, shall we pray? And he warned them that she had a real gruff voice, you see. And he said, just drop to your knees and we'll pray. He said, okay, I've got it. Well, Leonard Ravenhill said, nothing prepared me for what met my eyes as I opened the door. He said, I have traveled throughout Africa and I have seen alligators. And he said, I've seen this and I've seen, but he said, nothing prepared me for this woman as I saw her. You may not, he said, now this was not my words. He said, she was the ugliest woman I have ever seen. He said, she was so ugly. And she said, gentlemen, will you have tea? And they said, yes, please. So they sat down, they had tea. And when I say tea, that's a cup of tea. You see, it was England. And then she said, let us pray. And they dropped to their knees. And you know, that man said, she opened her mouth and began to pray. And he said, within 1 minute, I didn't know whether I was on earth or in heaven. You see, the beauty, that character, that loveliness of God, that preciousness was in her spirit. and just beauty irradiated out of her life. Isn't that neat? Okay, so back to 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 to 5. Some examples, these fiery darts that the enemy can throw at you. Somebody's ignoring you. Did you see that, sister? She walked right past you. She never even acknowledged. That's it. Look, she's going down to talk to sons of it. Look, you can, anyway, you can, you're nobody anyway. Now, I'm going to ask for a raise of hands. Who's ever had those thoughts? Isn't that amazing? You see, he's the same old devil, and he's just like a broken record. He uses the same thing over and over again. But the sad part about it, ladies, we listen to it. I challenge you every morning when you get up, you clothe yourself with that whole armor of God. Clothe yourself with that whole armor of God. You think you're no good. You're useless. You couldn't possibly be like so-and-so. I remember at one stage in my life, I couldn't even imagine that anybody would ever want to even come to my house to visit because I felt so unworthy. I thought, who are you? You haven't even got anything to offer anybody. I tell you what, those are lies. I've come to realize that I am beautiful. And this is not saying it in a proud way. I've come to realize that my God in me is lovely. And it's the most releasing, liberating feeling. Talk about woman's lib. It's got nothing on it. When you know who you are in God and what God is within you, it's wonderful. It's beautiful. We can overcome Satan by how? Revelation 12, 10 to 11 shows us how to do this. Hands up those who know the scripture before we even turn to it. Great. That's good. Excellent. They overcome Satan by what? The blood of the Lamb. They overcome him by the blood of the Lamb. It says here, now have come salvation and the power of the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. For the accuser of our brothers who accuses them before God day and night, he doesn't stop. He's always accusing. But they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. And they did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. And sisters, I believe that some of us are even going to die for Jesus. I believe that with all my heart. I believe that with all my heart. And let us not shrink back. Let us not shrink back from what God wants to do in your heart and life. We're going to turn over now to 1 Samuel chapter 17. 1 Samuel chapter 17. I know you've all, especially if you're a Sunday school teacher or a Bible school teacher, you probably know this story backwards, but we're going to go over it again because I believe it's a beautiful parallel between the children of God today and the enemy of our souls. And it says here, we're going to read from, just to give you a wee bit of background, that Jesse got David, the youngest of the family. He said, now go and see how your brothers are doing in the war. Quite unusual, isn't it? Just sort of pack them up with a lunch and send them over to see how the war's going. But that's how they did it in those days. And so David left. He obeyed and he went. And he ran to the battle lines and he greeted his brothers. And as he was talking with his brothers, Goliath, the Philistine champion from Garratt, he stepped out from his lines and shouted his, look at this word, his, if you've got your Bibles, can you read it through with me? Because you just, there's some little words I really want to pick out. And he shouted his usual defiance, and David heard it. Now, when the Israelites saw the man, they all ran from him in great fear. Now, let me just paint the picture here. David was just a shepherd boy. He was the youngest of all his brothers. I would imagine, I may be wrong, but I would imagine he'd be in his early teens. And his brothers would have probably been in their 20s, perhaps even in their 30s. Now, you know, it's interesting. These brothers had been, they were in this battle, and they came every Philistines were on that side, the Israelites were on that side, and there was a valley between them. They came out each morning prepared for battle. Now, I'm sure that those Israelites, they just didn't come out in their under tunics. They were dressed. You see, the sad part about it, they looked the part. They were dressed for battle. They looked the part, but they did nothing about it. And then this great big Goliath came out and he shouted his usual defiance. And David heard it. When the Israelites saw the man, they all ran away from him in great fear. Now the Israelites had been saying, "Do you see how this man keeps coming out? He comes out to defy Israel, the king. The king will give great wealth to the man who kills him. He will also give him his daughter in marriage and will exempt his father family from taxes in Israel." That would be neat, eh? They'd not have to pay taxes. David asked the men standing near him, he said, "What will be done for the man who kills this Philistine and removes this disgrace from Israel?" He was a disgrace. "Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God? Who is he?" That's what God is saying to you. Get your eyes up and realize you're not fighting each other. You're fighting the enemy of your soul. They repeated to him what they'd been saying and told him, "This is what's going to be done for the man who kills him." When Eliab, David's oldest brother, heard him speaking with the men, he burned with anger at David. You see, here was David. He had the Spirit of God in his life. And he could see that this great big overgrown giant was defying God. And his brother was so angry that David dared say that. But it was the truth. And I believe as you go out and you speak in truth, you are going to have your brothers and your sisters sometimes not understanding where you're coming from. But press on. And he burned with anger and he said, "Why have you come down here? And with whom did you leave those few sheep in the desert? I know how conceited you are and how wicked your heart is. You have only come down to watch the battle." "Now, what have I done?" said David. "Can't I even speak?" And then he turned around and he began to speak to the other men about it. And then David was overheard, and it was reported to Saul, and Saul, the king, sent to him. And David said to Saul, "Let no one lose heart." You see, remember that word hope? Well, we've got no perseverance, we have no hope. "Let no one lose heart on account of this Philistine. Your servant will go and fight him." Saul replied, "You're not able to go and fight against this Philistine. You're only a boy, and he's been a fighting man from his youth." But David said to Saul, he said, "Your servant has been keeping his father's sheep. When a lion and a bear came and carried off a sheep from the flock, I went after it, and I struck it, and I rescued the sheep from its mouth. When it turned on me, I seized it. And I've seized it by its hair, and I struck it, and I killed it. Your servant has killed both the lion and the bear. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, because he has defied the armies of the living God." Please put it into everyday life, ladies, as I'm speaking through. "The Lord who delivered me from the paw." You see, David realized that it wasn't anything on his behalf. He realized it was God in him. "The Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine." Saul said to David, "Go and the Lord be with you." And as you go, the peace of God is going to go with you too, ladies. As you go, as you step out and you be bold for God, he's going to be with you. But it says, as you go. You've got to go. You've just got to go. And then you'll find that peace and that boldness will follow you. Then Saul, he dressed David in his own tunic. The weapons of our warfare, they're not carnal, are they? See, Saul said, "I'll help this young guy out," which was probably just on the natural. He tried to help him out. But David said, "This is no good. I can't even move in this." You see, he was not going to fight in the natural. He said, "I can't go in these because I'm not used to them." So he took them off. Then he took his staff in his hand and he chose 5 smooth stones from the stream and he put them in his pouch and his sling in his hand and he approached the Philistine. Now meanwhile, the Philistine, he kept, and his shield bearer in front of him, kept coming closer to David. Have you ever had that giant that just keeps coming closer and closer and you just about have eyeball confrontation? David looked over, and he looked over David, and he saw that he was only a boy, and he despised him. Sisters, recognize this fact. The devil hates you. He's out to rob you. He's out to destroy you, and he's out to kill you. He said to David, "Am I a dog that you come to me with sticks?" And the Philistines cursed David by his dogs. "Come here," he said, "and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and to the beasts of the field." Now, what I want to encourage you is this. When the devil comes at you like a roaring lion, he's like a roaring lion. He is not a roaring lion. You have the Lion of Judah within you. Remember that. So when he comes at you like a roaring lion, you bounce back with the truth. So David said, you come to me with a sword and a spear and a javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will hand you over to me, and I will strike you down and I'll cut off your head. Today I will give the carcasses of the Philistine army to the birds of the air and the beasts of the field. You see, David turned it right round. He said, David, what you've said to me, God is going to do to you. All those that gathered here will know that it is not by sword, it is not by spear, as the Lord saves, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give all into our hands. Now the Philistine, he moved closer to attack him. What did David do? You look at verse 48, halfway through verse 48. David stood there and he kind of said, where is somebody? Come on, hold up a shield in front of me. Did he do that? The Bible says that David ran quickly towards the battle line to meet him. And sisters, this is what's on my heart this weekend, that you will run to that battle line with that battle axe in your hand. You see? With that war club that God has given you in your hand, to set the captives free, to plunder the gates of hell, to plunder hell, to tear open those gates that said will not prevail against God's children. The gates of hell will not prevail against God's people. You see, you run at those circumstances. Run at them. Don't run away any longer. You can do it, because it's not you, it's God working in you. And so David, he ran to the battle line to meet him. Reaching into his bag, he took out a stone and he slung it and struck the Philistine on the forehead. That was the only part that wasn't covered on that great big giant. Do you know, it reminds me that when we clothe ourselves with the whole armor of God in the morning, I do that every day. As we clothe ourselves with that whole armor of God and we go out to do battle against the enemy, do you realize something? When we use the shield of faith and we use that sword of the Spirit, he's standing there and he's got no armor at all. Isn't that exciting? He's got no armor at all because he's been stripped of it. Hasn't he? He's been stripped of every bit of authority, but God has given you and me that authority to do damage. So David triumphed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone. Without a sword in his hand, he struck down the Philistine and he killed him. And they won a great battle that day. Verse 25. I'm going to pick out these verses. The Israelites were in great fear. They ran away. Don't run away. Stand your ground. If you don't feel you've got the courage or the perseverance to stand your ground, we're going to pray for you very soon. We're going to get you to come out and we're going to pray that the very courage, the tenacity, the perseverance of God is going to be in your life. Don't run away. It's fun to fight. I used to run away, and it did me so much damage. It just, the more you run away and the more you listen to the devil's lies, the more he pours in the poison. He never ever thinks, well, Jan's had a bit of a rough deal this week. I think I'll just lay off a bit. He doesn't do it. When you're downest the most, he puts the boot in, because he's out to rob you and he's out to kill you. But rise up against that, my dear sisters. Rise up against that. Don't let him lay a blow on you. You lay the first blow. It says in the Word of God that in Psalm, I think it's 144, and I don't quite know the verse, it is God who trains our hands to war. Let's just quickly turn to that. I think, if anybody can find that before me, that'll be wonderful. I think it's 144. Is it in 144? Is that the right one? Pardon? Ah, verse 1. Okay. Praise be to the Lord my rock, who trains my hands to war, my fingers for battle. He is my loving God and my fortress, my stronghold, and he's my deliverer, my shield, in whom I take refuge. Read that whole psalm. It'll just thrill you. David recognized, verse 26, David recognized that Goliath was defying God. Recognize when people set themselves up against the Most High God, when those thoughts pour into your mind. Recognize, say, hey, that's not what my God says about the situation. I honestly, what Trevor and I are really doing at the moment, what God has laid on our heart, is when we get, if we go into an area and we sense this disunity, we go all out for unity. If we sense there's a spirit of unrest, we pray in peace. If we sense there's a spirit of sadness, we pray joy. Whatever you find the opposite, just whatever you find the situation against you, go for the opposite. If you find there's something, a stinginess, be generous. You see, it works. Verse 32, he wanted to fight Goliath because he knew that he wasn't trusting in his little slingshot. He was trusting in God. Verse 33. Discouragement. Saul discouraged Saul. He said, he reminded David that he was just a boy. And you're going to have times when you're just going to be discouraged, and he's going to remind you, who on earth do you think you are? You think you can possibly do damage? You're joking. You're only a little old lady. You're only a little girl. That's the lie. Never, ever listen to what he says. Always listen to what God's got to say, because he is the way, the truth, and the life. Verses 34 to 37, David told Saul how God had helped him with battles before, so he had that confidence. But you see, dear ones, as I say, when you get that, when the adversity builds, where is it on the front of it again? Adversity builds character and Christ-likeness. As we go through these things, looking into the face of Jesus, holding onto his hand, he's going to give us the battle strategy. He will. Verses 38 to 39, the armor was a hindrance to David. Now, I'm not talking about the armor of God. I'm talking about those with the natural things. It was a hindrance to David. Don't rely on the world's methods. If people come against you with accusations, don't you dare come back at them with accusations. Leave it to God. He's the vindicator. But you know, there's something about woman. We want to have the last say, don't we? And we just want to come out on top, put our cause. And that's an area that God has to deal with me continually. I'm learning to leave things with God. The battle is not mine, it's God's. Rely on God and his word. Verses 41 to 47, threats are thrown at David. He keeps reminding Goliath that he is defying the living God. If the devil keeps reminding you of your past, what you've done and what you haven't done, you remind him of his future. And what is his future? He is condemned to the everlasting fire, isn't he? When he reminds you of your past continually, you say, no, hang on a minute. You see, I'm taking these thoughts captive, you see. Hang on a minute. That's not, you see, honestly, if anybody looked in my bathroom or my bedroom at times, they'd think I was really quite funny, but this is what I do. I say, that is not what my God says about me. You see, you're taking those thoughts captive, you're bringing them into the obedience of Christ. And you see, and you just come out, you speak out, you run at that with the word of God, with the truth of God. And verses 48 to 50 is this. As Goliath approached, as he kept coming, David, he ran to meet him. Run. Don't worry about the threats or the opposition that keeps coming against you. Run to meet that giant. Remember, the Bible says that when the enemy comes in like a flood, God is going to lift up a standard against him. Isn't that neat? You have got God fighting for you. Now, what I want you to do now, I'm going to pray, and then as you respond to that prayer, we're going to have ladies come and pray. This is the area that I really want you that I sort of want to major on, if you like, is the area, if you're feeling a tug from God to do something for him, that you just feel there's a little bit of a stirring from God and you're just not quite sure which way to go. The devil said to you, who on earth do you think you are, Mrs. Big? You know, I've had all that. All God wants from you today, what I want you to say in your heart is, here I am, Lord, totally available to you. Lord, I want to use you to use me in your kingdom. Father, I know it's not by my might or power, but it's by your Spirit. And if you've got that tug in your heart, if you want more perseverance, if you want to be a battle axe for God, remember, for God, never be a battle axe in any other area, but be a battle axe, you know, so you can plunder the gates of hell. You can drive back the enemy. See those hurting, bruised ones, as the ladies have been talking about, binding up the broken hearts, setting the captives free. If you desire that in your life, I want to, after I pray, I want you to come forward, and the ladies are going to pray for you, and reach out to God and believe that there's going to be an impartation, one, of boldness, of stickability, of perseverance, and then that God will birth a vision in your heart and give you clear direction in your hearts and lives. Let's pray. Father, we just lift you up on the highest place. And we thank you, Father, that everything in this precious word is for us. And Father, we thank you that there is nothing, no weapon that's formed against us is going to prosper. Father, we thank you, Lord, that when we go out and do battle with the enemy, that you're there right with us and you have equipped us for battle. Father, you said that you've trained our hands to war. And we thank you for that, Father. And we pray, Lord, as these people respond, that, Father, you'll birth insight, you'll birth courage, you'll birth perseverance, tenacity, stickability. But then, Father God, you'll begin to stir up the gifts that you've placed, those talents that you've placed in their lives, that they've been hanging on to and the devil's been saying, you're just not good enough. Father, that's a lie. Right now, we just break that lie and the power of that lie in the name of Jesus Christ. We rebuke you, devil, and we resist those lies in the name of Jesus. How dare you lie to God's children? We will not allow it one second longer. We take captive those thoughts. Spirit of God, you come now. You have your way. And you speak and teach these women things to come. As only you can, you begin to speak into their hearts the things that you would have them do. In the mighty name of our Savior and Lord, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.